to come to you with a project today. I got an order to do for a set of my bull's head spatula and fork. And this is the spatula forging part. And I'll do a video on that someday. But the idea is, again, it's a railroad spike. You can see that, I think. Where I put a bull's head on the end of it. Very much the same as doing a ram's head. We'll walk through that. For this video, I'll show you how I do the fork, and then we'll come back another time and we'll do the spatula and put the platter on and all that. So that's this one. Let's get started. The thing about this project is now we have a use for, well, now, but here's one of the examples of a use for one of the modern, oh my God, it's Monday, mild steel, or the lower carbon steel railroad spikes. That'll work just fine. For the fork part, for both pieces, you want to choose a halfway decent spike because you have a lot to do with this. Especially with the fork, we want to make sure we have enough steel left on the end here. So what we're going to do is put this in the forge, get it brought up to temperature, get that bull's head put on first, and go from there. The background noise, we got some rain today, which is awesome. We got a couple of fans going, so maybe a little extra noise, but hopefully it'll drown itself out. All right, the first thing we're going to do, get a nice good heat on that spike. I'm just going to bring that down, and again, you got to be careful not to roll this as you do, because that will come back to haunt you. Get that taper down, put the horns in the nose. Now the horns will be on this side, nose will be on that side. Now the thing about the spike, and I don't know if you can see it, is that this is a really disrupted kind of shape quite often. So I want to make sure that in the process of making that nose, I don't do a whole lot of rolling, otherwise you end up losing the mouth. But we're okay for now. Next step is going to be to heat this thing back up and then drop that nose out a little bit. Right, so that I don't just, deform the steel that I'm gonna use for the horns. I quench them a little bit just to harden them up. And again, we're really after just that nose part. I drop that right over the hardy hole. That's the best edge I have, and I just kind of drop that down to pick up a little more steel. Now this poor spike with this, can you see it there? I think you can. A little closer. Yeah. See this? That's gonna cause me grief, all right? We gotta work that steel back. I can't have that little lip there. It's not gonna happen. So some of the spikes do that. So we'll spend a little time cleaning that up and we'll drop that nose a little more. Again, because each spike has its own little wear personality, sometimes you gotta change up your plan a little bit. All I'm trying to do is push that little rolled lip in a little without rolling it over. Just kind of upsetting it back into the mass. I do have a bit of a crease here that I hope doesn't come back to haunt me. What happens if you're not careful is you go to cut that mouth and that little crease that might form in there drops off and now you don't have the mouth. Before I go back to dropping that nose is I'm going to stretch out this part here a little bit because we don't need all that mass in this particular item. For a knife, I try not to do that, because I like to have as much grip as I can. But for these barbecue forks, barbecue spatulas, even the garden troughs, thin that out so I can have more mass at the bottom. It doesn't take much, just one heat. And you pick up a good quarter to a half an inch in length, plus it cleans that up a little. I usually use the 3-pounder to get it started because it's got a bit of a rounded nose. And I just go back and flatten it with the 4-pounder just to clean it up. We're going to cut some grooves in there eventually, so the flatter it is, the more clean it is, the better those grooves cut. All right, let's go back to this head. It's a little bit different than, I don't know why, but it looks different than normal. But we'll drop a little bit more of a nose and we'll go back to work. I don't need much more steel move. Cool the horns back down again, drop that nose, and I think when we get done we'll be okay, because that part there we're going to squeeze down using the vise, which I'll show you in a second. Same thing over here, we're going to kind of consolidate this way. But I think, again, I'm not happy at all with it, My horns are rolled a little, my nose has got a wacky little fold in there, but let me see what happens. Next step, we're going to put a decent heat on there. We're going to put it in the vise so it lays flat, just snug, not super tight. Because we want it to be able to move a little bit. And I'm going to work this top a little snugger than that. I'm going to work this top down towards the front. I'm also going to work these horns out. Again, I'm doing a little extra work on this one because of the odd shapes that we have going on there. Get out of my pocket. But you can see what we did is now we have these horns a little bit more controlled, and this nose, that extra mass, we moved it up and out, so we got a little bit more to work with. So it looks much better. I still have a fold here. I'm a little worried about my mouth when we get to the point of doing that, but let's go back to the heat. Back after another heat, we're gonna go back to the vise. And again, what I do here depends on my mood. Very often I start putting the tapers in for the nose, just so I have an idea of, I don't know, what's the word I'm looking for? It'll come to me. Not the symmetry, but the scale, the proportions, that's it. And then I start putting in where I want to split these horns. And normally I have more heat than this, but that's fine. When you don't, go ahead and put the lines in, because you really want to keep, just like with the ram's head, the mass equal on both sides. So that's good. I wish I could have gotten a little bit more cut with that heat, but like I said, we've been kind of messing with the snows a little. But you can see, get that line mark so when you come back next time for a good cut, you're going to be more where you want. And I can see that I'm a little heavier on this side than that side, so when I cut, I'll cut at a bit of an angle just to pick up a little bit of the bottom mass. You want to pick up a decent amount of heat on this one. Either about straight up and down if you can. Put it in there snug and then go ahead and start cutting that, separating those horns. I don't cut all the way through because I don't want to mess up my animal, and it takes more than one heat. So I'll get it pretty darn close, or whatever I can out of the heat. Now it is important, both this and the ram's head, that you try to get that split as close to the main body of the spike as you can. That gives you a little bit more meat to play with those horns. So one more heat, I think we'll have them cut. Final cut, I've made up this little thing. It's not a big deal. It's, I don't know what the heck it's made out of. Half inch, three quarter, mild steel. It's my sacrificial piece. It's a little bit bent right now, actually. Let's straighten it back up. And that hooks right over the top of the vise like this so that I can chisel into that without messing up my vise. A decent amount of heat on this one. Drop it on your sacrificial piece. Everything's not where it belongs. And then you finish your cut right down to the steel, or the bottom piece. And I have this railroad spike that I put a pretty good rounded nose on, kind of like a fuller. And I go ahead and spread those horns a little bit like that, just to give me some more working space. And up here at the top, I put a couple of hits just to put a little bit of detail in of those horns rolling into the forehead. Kind of like that. So there's the split. You see where we're going, very much like the ram's head. What we'll do now is we'll spread those horns apart, and we'll put a bit of a shape on them, and then we'll come back and finish the face. Because I don't like to do the final parts of the horn until I'm done with the heavy heat stuff. Get those horns spread apart, regardless of whether it's the ram's head or the bull's head. Very often what I'm going to do is cool this nose down in the quench so that I can use that as a point of hammering. And there's a couple of things you can do. You can go ahead right over the side of the anvil and just give her a couple of hits there. Just start spreading things up, get these things rolled down a little bit. and especially for the bowl, well, only for the bowl. I'll go right over this spot and I'll take the peen side of the hammer because I really want those horns out flat. Because a bull's head, bull's horns don't come back like a ram's head will. So a little bit of that kind of spreading motion, and then I'll go ahead and start working these horns a little, just straightening his face back up. Normally, depends on what, again, it depends on the spike. Normally I'd be able to flatten these right out in this first heat, but if you notice, I got a lot of mass here in depth, and it's not gonna look natural if I go ahead and spread those out. So I wanna go ahead and start putting a little bit of a narrowness to those horns first, and then I'll flatten them. Back with a 3-pounder with a decent amount of heat. I'm just gonna start working those horns. Typically I pick one, and like I said before, we got a lot of mass right here. So that's what I'm gonna work. Just where the horn meets the head, so that I can seal some of that mass, but also I want it to look more realistic. So I'm just pulling that down right off the edge of the anvil. To the point where I think I have what I want that starting part of the horn diameter to be. Really, you don't need to steel a lot here. There's a lot of steel in there to make that horn. It doesn't have to be much longer than it is, really. You see what I did? You see how ugly and fat this piece is in here, all right? But I just kind of clean that up so where it comes into the head, it's more proportionate. Here's that word again. Let's do the other side. Open this other side a little now. Do a few of these, you kind of get an idea of where you can hit and where you can't hit. You don't have a lot of room to work. I like using the 3-pound hammer, even though it's a little bit on the heavy side as far as size, to get into that corner, but it does the trick once you get used to it. Now I'm doing all this now because a couple of missed hammer strikes and you'd be messing up the face if you already put the face in. But at this point, I think I'm okay with what I got. At least we got some proportion there at the beginning part of the horn. I think I got a little extra steel on this side, like I mentioned before. But now I'll go back and I'll flatten those things out. Let's see if we can get those horns out where I want them to be. Again, I'm gonna come back to this location. I'll actually hit with the hammer straight up and see how they'll roll right out. Clean up the inside here a little bit. Now the thing that I'm trying to do is kind of fake nature here a little bit, because if you notice, well, it's a little hot right now, but you're not going to have as much of a valley between those horns as you would a ram or something like that. So I kind of want them as straight out as I can, with as little valley. It's cooling down where you can see it now, with as little valley here as possible. But that gets me where I need to be. I can now work those horns. Once the face is in, I'm kind of okay with the shape of the face right now, as far as where everything is. Now, one of the differences between a ram and a bull, God, I don't like that bull. Let's see if it's cool enough so you can see it. Where is it? See that line right in there? That's a fold, and when I go to cut that mouth, I might be in big trouble. But anyway, the difference between, I found anyways, in making the ram's head versus the bull's head, is that with the bull's head, you want a little bit flatter nose. You're gonna find that a cow or a bull has a little flatter nose than a ram, is a little more pointy. But I think we're in good shape. Let's go back to doing the face. I'm gonna show you now because I'm probably not gonna stop to show you later. So the punches that I use, very, very much the same as the ram's head. I use a flat punch, something relatively narrow. It doesn't have to be super narrow. And then a pretty good size rounded flat punch. I have a rounded nosed punch that I use sometimes for the eye, and then I have a smaller diameter flat punch round that I use for the nostrils and things. So that's what I'm going to be using. Here we go. The heat on this is good. I use the horns to help hold it from moving. Come in here. I'll take my small 2-pounder and I'll put a couple of dents in these corners of the nose to represent where the nostrils will be, and then I'll come in with my larger round flat punch. And I'll drop those nostrils in. It's an important thing that they kind of line up. So the second one you might do a little slower than you do the first one, so that you can move it a little if you need to. Now I'm coming relatively straight onto the animal there, okay? From there I take the same punch, I come up to the eyes, and with the bull I come out more at an angle, more perpendicular to the face. And again, I'm just gonna put my marks in so I can make sure I'm not gonna end up with a cross-eyed cow, unless that's what you're after. And then I go a little deeper with them. Things are looking okay. You have time to work these, especially when you need to readjust where you want them to be. All right, so for the nostril, I'll go with this smaller round point, and I'll just put a secondary hole in there just to kind of give it a little depth. Doesn't take much. Those can make you look crooked too, so you gotta make sure those are where you want them to be. And then for the eye, I'll either use the same technique or I'll take this rounded nosed punch and just put a bit of a eyeball or a pupil or whatever you want to call it in there, just to add a little more character. Now even though we're at a pretty black heat, you can also come in now and start putting some lines. Now I like to put a line like a V here where the horns are. You got plenty of heat to do that. And then I put one or two lines right down through the nose. One or two, because if one is not centered, then I put one next to it to make it look centered. Just like that. I'll go ahead and walk this chisel around and close to the nostril to cut kind of a flare in there. I'll do the same thing on the other side, just to get the noses flaring a little bit. I'll probably zoom in on that a little for you. All right, so you can see the V that I put in here, all right? And I roll over the nostrils and a couple lines down the nose. Now, typically I have enough heat to also do a roll over the top of the eyebrows, or to make the eyebrows, all right? But we'll go back. We gotta have one more heat anyway, typically, to clean things up, so I'll come back. The second heat, you don't need as much as you started with, because when you're putting the final details in, a little bit less heat kind of helps you out a little. So what did I forget? I forgot to put the rolls over the eyes, so let me do that. And that's where you can make the bull a happy bull, or an angry bull, depending on where you go, or a sad bull. All right. And again, you don't need a lot of heat to make that happen. Now the next thing that I do is I take the peen side of my 2-pounder, and I just kind of add some random texture all over the piece. What that does is it softens those chisel lines. Gives it a sense of depth, like hair. Now I might go a little heavier down the nose to help put a bit of a separation in there, but just to soften that up. Alright. And I'll show you what I got. Where am I? Oh yeah, we're zooming. Alright, so you kind of see, let's get a little closer here. Oh, those little hammer marks soften everything up. It's great. Now, the best part about this project today is the first thing I was supposed to do, I forgot to do. I always put the mouth in first. So I'm not sure why I didn't, because the mouth determines where the nose goes. And you can kind of see where the nostrils are on the bottom now. I don't have as much room to play. So I hope I don't just hurt myself in that process. But let's go back and put that mouth in, dumbass. A right decent amount of heat on this to get that mouth cut, because you got only a little bit of room to play here. I'm going to go a little higher than normal on account of the fact of that roll that I've been talking about all this time. I used to do one across the front and I put a couple in the corner. Again, usually my nose isn't there yet, so I have lots of room to play, and then I can compensate by moving the nose later. But hey, you got to do what you got to do. You got to be careful going too far up the side, or you end up with this smirking cow that you're not going to want smirking so much. But I'm okay with that. I'll show you what happens almost always. If I can in time, I really don't want to do another heat, because we end up with a couple of rollovers in this corner of the mouth, the bottom corner. Can you see that? It just doesn't look right. Right? They're sticking out there. So I take my little 2-pounder, typically while it's in the vise still, and I just kind of bring those up. And that's typically, this one here rolls a little more than I want, so I'm going to bring it out here a little. Typically, that'll bring those corners up, and actually, for some reason, I don't know what it is. All of this is normally done before I have any details on the face. By bringing those corners up a little, it kind of gives a little more realism to the mouth. I don't know why, but it does. More like it's not just going bleh, it's going, well, rolling this mouth. So I don't know if you can see that or not. Roll those corners up. And the face is done now. It'll look good once she's all wire brushed up. All right, so at this point, we're gonna go back, and before I finish the horns, because they're gonna get pretty delicate, I'm gonna go ahead and do the handle, cut the lines, put the twist in. Once that's done, I can still handle the piece and do the horns without messing that twist up. And again, it's all about a staging. I can't use the vise with the twists in there. I'm gonna mess up the twist. So you gotta get the face done before you put the twist in. And you can do the horns before you put the twist in, but you stand a chance of melting the horns when you're trying to do the twist because there's so much heat required for that to happen. So that's the next thing. We're gonna get the handle, the twist, lines cut, and we'll finish up the horns. All right, so I usually go a little hotter, so I hope that doesn't come back to haunt me, but I'm gonna do, I don't know what I did on the other one. Okay, I'll be back. Again, this is a set, so I think we'll better match, right? Let's go look at the other one for a second. Dang it, Bobby. I looked at it, and I made a mental note, but in the 30 minutes I've been working on this thing, I forgot it. Look at the spatula handle. Again, the reason I had to look is very often I'll put two lines in, sometimes I'll put one line in. In this case, it's a single line, then a twist, so a relatively easy. So remind me of that as I get to the point where I'm doing it. Here we go, we decided single line to match the other one. We'll go ahead and do that now. Dang, I wonder why it's not as hot as I want it to be. We got lots of room to play here along the spike, so you don't have to be really close to the head like you would be a knife, because when we get drawing things out, we're going to have plenty of metal, I think. It's not as deep as I want. So again, one line on all four sides. That's where a little more heat would have helped, but I think we'll be all right. Yeah, we're deep enough there. Okay. So with this particular twist, one line on all four sides. For this step, you don't want to mess around with your heat. You want a good amount of heat on there so that you can do what you want it to do. I usually go right about to the bottom of the lines, depending on how much I think I need to stretch. We'll do one full turn. Ooh, I forgot I narrowed that. See, now this is why you want lots of heat, just in case crap like this happens. And we'll go one full turn, and we want to make sure that we're facing square when we get done. Don't let the horns screw you. I don't need any curves in any directions. I want everything right the way I want it. I'm looking at this one eyeball, and I'm not happy with how much I put that. I can do that without messing things up too much. I can move it in the center a little bit. I think I'm okay with that. Boom, 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 boom. Make sure we're relatively straight. If not, you're going to go over to the anvil with a wooden hammer, straighten things up. But there we go. There's our twist. Time to finish the horns. Once the horns are done, we draw out the rest of the handle, remembering to leave stuff for a fork at the end. Horns, if everything works well, you should be able to pull this off in one heat. So again, wherever I can work them without hitting the face, that's what I'm going to do. Stretch those things out. We don't need to go as far as we do with a ram, but we do want it to look relatively natural. Here's the trick. As I'm rolling this to turn that square into a round, you can control the angle of the head so that as you roll that out to the point, you can also be shaping the curve of the horn. all done with that big old 3-pounder. See what I did there? Not only did I put the tape around, but as I was finishing off the round, I also put the end of that horn in, or the curve of that horn in, so that I don't have to go back and mess with it again. So, big thing is, hopefully the next one's about the right size. Just as lucky with the other one, very often you're going to find yourself, with the bowls especially, I'm switching sides here, maybe not at the beginning. When you're doing that final shaping, again, you're trying to make sure whatever you're doing now is going to match diameters closely anyway. Oh, I lost my thing. That ain't going to help me a bit. Again, the second one, if you mess up and make this one larger or smaller, well, larger especially than the other one, then you're going back to do all that work again. We don't want to do that, so I'm just going to take one more heat again because I'm a little heavier than I want to be. Won't take but a second to heat that end up rather than fight it. And again, you may find when you're ready to put that curb in, going to the other side of the anvil allows you to do that. Yeah, now we don't need a lot of extra heat here, but I want to have enough to that point in there and work everything else back. This one's giving me grief for some reason. You can do it. So we've gone a little too far on the angle. Is when you get done in one heat, hopefully, I don't want that round anymore, or just a couple of heats anyway, you can get the symmetry that you want. Now again, it doesn't have to be exact, nothing in nature is, but it should be what you want it to be, which I don't mind, I just want a little curve it. This isn't horrible. See, this one's a little more rounded than that one is. I don't like that. Always look at it from that direction, left to right. You want them to be similar. Enough. I'm a little short. I'm going to go one more heat on that. Again, maybe I'm a little too picky. Guess it's who you are and what you do. That's that one. That looks a lot better. One side's a little heavier. This side comes. Perfect, it wouldn't be handmade. One's a little lower than the other. You see that? This one, where is it? This one comes down, that one comes up. We're gonna fix that too. So, yeah, I'm spending a few more heats than I want to on this. But if I'm not happy, I can't expect a customer to be. That's for sure. But every time you freak with it, you freak with messing it up, too. And I think that's as far as we're going to go with it. Yeah, I don't know, boys. I just wish that was a little higher, that's all. You're going to freak it up, Chandler. Then you're going to be crying. Then you're going to be crying. Alright, I think I'm okay with that. It's still a little low. but it's good enough for me. I like it. It's good. All right, so there's four extra heats on that darn thing. Camera makes it look really bad. It doesn't look nearly that bad in real life. There, I'll do it. I'll tip it a little bit. Anyway, let's get the rest of this thing done. Now is we need to start stretching this thing out into whatever length, 16, 18 inches, or something like that. But I need to make sure I leave enough to make those forks. And I haven't done enough of those to feel comfortable with what that amount of steel is. So we're going to leave that much, and I hope I'm doing the right amount. I think that should be fine. We can always steal more back, right? The spatula is easy because you just need to have that flat spot out there. But with the fork, you got some work to do. So we'll go ahead and start stretching this out from this point back till we get, I don't know, something like rim. Oh, that long plus the fork. The technique you want to use, I tend to use the edge, the anvil a little bit, and I use the horn a little bit, top fuller, bottom fuller, whatever it is you're going to use, power hammer. Go ahead and start stretching that out. With a taper. You can be a bit monkey with a hammer at the beginning here, but make sure you're planning where you're going. Your diameters and stuff like that along the way, but we got a good stretch on that one. One more decent stretch down here at the bottom. Notice I'm not going up as high. I'm okay with the thickness up there. See what we got. It's not bad. The length of a fork. Now I'll round this off. The top, I'm just stop twisting it right now. I'm just softening, and then I'll go into a full round typically. By the time I get that rounded off, I think we're going to be long enough. One more heat. Enough heat to let me do what I want to do on this. Now this will end up twisting the piece, so you got to make sure you're planning for that, which I hope I am. We'll go back through, do what we need to make it look right. Sure, we're looking okay-ish up here, especially for that transition from square goes to round. It's kind of all I'm working right now. I think we're good from here to here, from here to the end. That's the only thing I'm focusing on right now. We'll get that relatively straight. So I probably won't be going back to heat that again. To make the transitions look smooth. I mean, smooth for what I'm after. This is supposed to have a good hammered texture most of the way down through there. And so you're happy with it. All right, so I'm happy down to here. We're going to stretch a little bit more of this and do that fork. I'm going to stretch a little bit more of this down here. Just a little thinner. Thank you. again, we're doing a little fine tuning and we're doing a little stretching at the same time. Get my 2-pounder in, because that'll give you many more hits per inch and a more rounded texture. And I think we're okay with that. So let's go ahead now and we're going to work from about here back and make sure I'm okay with the straightness of it. Bit of a hooky hook here. As soon as he takes 3 backs to take it out, I'm okay with that. It's good to have bad eyesight. Now, from here to here, we're done. I wish we were totally done, but I like that length. I think that's good. My guess is we're looking at. So there's 12 inches to the end. So by the time we get done, we're gonna be 14, 16 inches long. I think that's good. Got a lot of steel down here, so we might end up with a little more length. Next thing we need to do is kind of get that piece centered and then flattened out enough and then split into a fork. We've had a couple of hiccups along the way. It's been 1 hour since we started the project. So that's a lot of friggin' work. It's a lot of work. Charge a good money, good penny for something like this. Just see what we can do about getting stuff kind of where we want. Don't mind having the taper from the original spike perpendicular to the up and down part of the handle. And I'm just going to go ahead and thin that off. Now this is very much, except there's a lot more steel down here, very much what I would do with my spatulas. Just get that last piece and then start flattening it out. But I like to flatten it out a little bit. It makes cutting straight through a lot easier and a lot easier to maintain the same mass on both sides. I think I'm okay with that. What I'm going to do, I think we can use that. Can we use that maybe? With my black heat, I'm going to take my chisel and I'm going to just put some lines in so I can start finding center of mass here, so I don't have to mess around, hopefully. I'm okay with that. Once I split these. So just trying to, you know, kind of took a couple of different, a couple of different lines there. But the better you can do it, putting the same mass on both sides, happier you're going to be here in a minute. So back in the heat, let's split that. Chandler has not made himself a hole down yet, so we'll use my improvised chain hole down. I'm going to go with a smaller chisel and just take my time through here rather than the longer chisel, longer in cut and size. Give me a little more control over where I'm going with this. You notice I have a piece of sacrificial underneath, and I'm hoping I'm leaving enough mass up here so that when I get it cut, I can go ahead and work that out without having it too thin up there. Alright, that's pretty good. One more heat and I think we'll have it cut. Again, we might have been able to do that quicker, but I like to take my time just a little bit there. Because I'd like to just cut this from the same side the rest of the way, it gives a little bit too much meat on the bottom pieces. So we're going to go ahead and come from this side. It makes cleaning those tines up a little easier because that ridge is in the center rather than on one side. And split it to the same height. Kind of like that. I think we're good. Just like that. Man, we're almost out of video. Alright, I'm almost out of data on this car, but what we have to do, what we need to do now, however you decide to do it, is get these things spread out and just cleaned up. I like to get them as far apart as I can so that I can get that fracture point out of the inside. We kind of work our way down to that a little. gives us the ability to use this side of the handle a lot. Alright, so we're doing pretty good. Another heat. Clean the inside of that off is to use the vise, the back side of your peen, just to round that off and get rid of that edge there. Gently clean that inside off a little bit. What you gotta do is work these tines out, work them square. It's easier to draw that way. And again, when you're going down to a fine point, work from the point back. My advice, because you got a less chance of it splitting that way. Work it hot. Doesn't take long to heat these tines up once they get smaller. Just keep going back to the heat. Worst thing to do is split out that end. Stuff like rebar and railroad spikes, they got something in them that make them want to split. Maybe it's just enough carbon, I don't know. And again, I'm judging when I go round with this. How big of a diameter do I want? And I'm happy with the way that one looks right there. So let's go around with it. I'm out of time. Alright, so we're going to take a small hammer on this and we're just going to go ahead and do our round now. That tip up just a little bit. I don't want to be rounding that tip when it's not orange. Not worried too much about shape right now. You can be left straight if you want. I'm worried about function. I want it relatively smooth. Alright, about like that is good. And now we'll get the other tine going. Take you along for the ride again. Again, just work it square to stretch it. Do it over the horn of the animal if you're in a hurry. And then as you get to a certain point, you want to start working the point back, okay? This is neat. Now again, the key here is you gotta stretch it just short of how long you want it so that when you put the round in, you end up with a little more length anyway. It's kind of a tricky game to play, but you want to do it right, otherwise you're cutting the tine and going back and reworking things, which I do a lot. Let's see if we can go ahead and get this thing where you want it to be. And again, I'm judging the thickness back here against this one, as well as the length. It's not as easy as it seems. Getting pretty darn close here, so I want to get that point down to the right diameter. And once we're there, we'll go back for a rounding heat. And we'll see how well we did. I'm guessing. Maybe there's a more traditional way of doing this, but. You take a look from center to here, we're at a little short of 3, and center to here, we're just a little short of 3. We're pretty darn close, and I still have to split the round in, so we'll see. Go ahead and round this one off. We'll heat that tip up a little bit. Don't take much to do. Alrighty. Come on, when the truth is coming, do we have the right length? There's a little crooked here. Might as well get that straightened up. Looks good. So now we'll heat both tines over the horn, make our fork. Watch our heat on this a little bit. We want enough heat. We'll get straight. We'll find where we want this to be. There's a lot of different techniques that you can use to make this happen and to make this even. I want them narrower. And you can also play your length a little bit to even those up a little. So we are not exactly where I want to be. So we're a little longer over here than there, but if you notice, this one comes out wider than that one. So that's how we're going to fix that. Do that now. So we're going to come down here a little and come out here a little. All right, just like that. You can go a little more. We're getting pretty darn close there now. At least enough for cowboy use anyway. I'm liking that. Straighten that. Pencil up a little bit. I think we're in good shape there. I really do. Kind of like that. They're pretty darn close to exact, which I think is good. A little bit of a taper in. What do they look like on camera? They look pretty good, don't they? Yeah, I think that's good enough. Full show. I kind of like it. It's got a little bit of a hook up that way, but I like that. I think I'm happy with it. Again, this is where you're fine-tuning, and time is money, but quality is money next week, right? More customers, more repeats. I like it. It's rough enough. It's got just the right amount of hammering for me. There's a little bit that I don't like in here. See that? There's a little bit of a fold over there, but functionally, it's not going to affect anything. Cosmetically, it's on the bottom. I think I'm okay with that. And we're going to go ahead and put this on the wire wheel, clean up everything. From here down, I might hit it with the grinder, and I'll run the tines gently on the grinder just to get them a little bit smooth and sharp. Again, that's a fork. It's got to stick into something. But I'm happy with the length. I think it's good. And let's finish it up, and I'll be back. Got her cleaned up. Wire wheel from here to, well, here to here. And then I just run this gently over the belt grinder, and I go a couple of grits on the fork. And as you can see, it turns out to be a decent little barbecue fork with a bull's head. Be careful, when you say bull head, they'll think there's a fish on the end. All right, it's cool. This is the spatula handle that'll go with the set. So they turned out, I think, a nice matching set. Not perfectly matched, but good enough. And by the time I put, now I do, I think, a 3x5 or something platter on the end. Which, again, I'll do a video on that one. I think they're going to look really cool. It'll be done today and hopefully delivered today. So there it is. One bull's head barbecue fork. Enjoy. Catch you next time. It took about, I'd say a little less than an hour and a half to make. Almost an hour and a half. That's a long time. It's a lot. You got to charge a good penny for that. There you go. Hour and a half. I'm out of here now. Bye.